This day. Today is the 29th day of the month of Shabbat. And I wanted to talk about a passage of scripture that we highlighted about a month ago from the Gospel of Luke, which we used to draw attention to the attitude of a couple of Yeshua's disciples toward a Samaritan village when they didn't respond to Messiah the way they thought they should have. But I'd like to look at that passage again, and this time emphasize Yeshua's focus, his attitude. It says in Luke chapter 9, "Now it came to pass, when the time had come for him to be received up, that he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, and sent messengers before his face. And as they went, they entered a village of the Samaritans to prepare for him. But they did not receive him, because his face was set for the journey to Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, 'Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, just as Elijah did?' But he turned and rebuked them and said, 'You do not know what manner of spirit you are of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them.' And they went to another village." As I said, we called attention to the response that James and John gave. They're desiring to rain fire down upon them because they feel that they have disregarded the Messiah in some way. But compare that to Yeshua's response. There's this sharp contrast. And that is, first, he made it clear he didn't come to destroy men's lives. He came to save them. And secondly, because he remained on the objective, he just went to another village. He didn't allow what people said or didn't say, didn't do, to deter him from his mission. He set his face to go to Jerusalem. And in my opinion, you and I would do very well to follow this example. While it is important to profess the Messiah, to follow the Messiah by keeping his commands and instructions, I believe it is just as important to do so the way he did it, to observe how he did things. He didn't let people deter him or distract him. He didn't allow what they said about him to distract him or what they didn't say about him. He didn't allow what people weren't doing that they should have been doing or what they weren't doing that, or anyway, he didn't let people distract him from what he's supposed to be doing. In fact, we could make the argument that because he came to save men's lives, it was important for him to not allow these Samaritans to deter him from this, that they couldn't be saved or they couldn't have the opportunity to be saved if he didn't set his face to go up to Jerusalem. Therefore, shouldn't we follow that example? Shouldn't we remain on and focused upon the things that the Father has set before us to do, and that is in spite of what people may be saying about us, to us, not doing, doing? Notice what happened just after this exchange. "Now it happened, as they journeyed on the road, that someone said to him, 'Lord, I will follow you wherever you go.' And Yeshua said to him, 'Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head.' Then he said to another, 'Follow me.' But he said, 'Lord, let me first go and bury my father.' And Yeshua said to him, 'Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God.' And also another also said, 'Lord, I will follow you, but let me first go and bid them farewell who are at my house.' But Yeshua said to him, 'No one, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God.'" So I believe the message here is very clear. Yeshua admonishes us to stay focused and do what he has set before us to do, and not let anyone, anything, distract us from doing that. On the other hand, we also see that men will typically provide every excuse they possibly can to do just that, to get distracted. And it doesn't have to be burying your dead. It doesn't have to be saying goodbye to those that you're going to leave behind. Sometimes that distraction can be focusing on everyone else, what they're saying, what they're not saying, what they're doing that they shouldn't be, what they're not doing that they should be. Sometimes we allow our distraction to be clothed in robes of piety. My argument here today is that we should resist that inclination and stay on the road before us and set our face to go up to our Jerusalem, so to speak. That is, to come into our purpose and not to be deterred and not to be distracted. Also, keep this in mind. That season for purpose will come very quickly, and once that opportunity has passed, we may never see it again. Yeshua walked this earth for over 30 years, but he fulfilled his purpose in just 3 days. Something to consider. And while you're considering it, consider also joining us tomorrow. We'll see you then. Shalom.
release from in these last days.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Harcia Austin, are you online for opening prayer?
Shabbat Shalom, hallelujah. Praise God, hallelujah. Thank you, Father, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We praise you, O God. O Father, there is none like you. We worship you, we adore you, Father. Blessed is your name forever and ever. Praise be to God. Father, we thank you for this Shabbat. We thank you, God, for being with us. We thank you, God, for bringing us together again to hear from you, to sup with you, Father God, just to be in your presence. Father, it's a beautiful thing when we get together. Father, we thank you for watching out for us, for directing us, for giving us your word, for directing our steps, Father, as we follow you, as we obey you, Father God. Guide us and direct us continually, O God. Father, if there's anything in our hearts, anything that we have done, Father, that is not pleasing to you, forgive us, O God. Father, we desire to walk in your path, Father God, to be led by you, Father God. Cleanse us of everything that is not of you, O God. Teach us your way, teach us your Torah, your precepts, O God. Enlighten us, Father, that we may go forth, Father God, and proclaim your name, your goodness, and your love, Father. For there are many out there who need you, who need a touch from you, who need your love. Father, we thank you for our pastor Israel that you placed in our midst, Father God, to teach us, to lead us, to guide us. Father God, I pray that you bless her continually, undergird her, Father God, surround her with your angels, with your guidance, with your protection. Father, I thank you for being with us, Father, this Shabbat, Father. Heal us where we need to be healed, O God. Touch us where we need to be touched. Deliver us, O God, where we need to be delivered. Father, we have dependence and reliance on you, for you alone are our God, our Elohim, our all in all. We praise you this day, and we give you all the honor and the glory in the name of Yeshua. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I give God all the glory, all the honor and praise, because he's an awesome God. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 We give him all the glory, honor, and praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Signs, wonders, and miracles are released by my spirit. In these last days, I will pour out my spirit on all people. My Holy Spirit will give dreams and visions to your sons and daughters. All my servants will prophesy. I will show you signs and wonders in the heavens above and on the earth. Many will call on my name and be saved. I have many different kinds of gifts for my servants, but my Holy Spirit is the one who distributes them to you. To some, he gives a message of wisdom, to another, a message of knowledge, and to another, great faith. Some will receive gifts of healing, miraculous powers, and prophesy from my spirit. Others will be able to use great discernment or will have my gifts of speaking in tongues and interpreting tongues. All my gifts are the work of my Holy Spirit. Earnestly desire my spirit's giftings for you. Father, fill us with your Holy Spirit and count us worthy to be filled with the power to perform signs, wonders, and miracles in your name. Your power will confound and defeat all the powers of darkness and will cause many to desire your salvation. Your power is awesome and mighty to overcome all the works of the devil. Amen. You will overcome the devil by the blood of my son. Just as the blood of a lamb, sprinkled on doorposts in Egypt by my chosen people, established a covenant of blood with me and protected them from the destruction that I brought to those who had enslaved them, so too have I established a covenant of blood with you. Through the blood of my dear son Yeshua, which covers you, I have redeemed you from the curse of sin and have adopted you as my own dear child. I have equipped you with everything good for doing my will, and I will work in you to cause you to do what is pleasing to me. Through the blood of Messiah, you can have confidence to come into my presence. In his blood, I have given you redemption, forgiveness of sins, and have redeemed you from the power of evil. We have eternal redemption through the power of the blood of Mashiach. We have been raised to new life in Mashiach so that we serve the living God. We overcome the devil through the blood of Yeshua. Through him, we are made perfect and have the confidence to enter in the presence of God. Amen.
Amen.
Stephanie?
Acts 23:1-11. And Paul earnestly beholding the council said, "Men and brethren, I have lived all good conscience before God until this day. And the high priest Ananias commanded them that stood by him to smite him on the mouth. Then Paul said unto him, Thou shalt smite thee, thou whited wall, for thou smitest thee a whited wall. Thou to judge me after the law and commandest me to be spitten contrary to the law? And they that stood by said, Thou art thou the God's high priest? Then said Paul, I was not, brethren, that he was the high priest, for it is written, Thou shalt not speak evil of the ruler of thy people. But when Paul perceived that the one part were Sadducees, and the other Pharisees, he cried out in the council, Men and brethren, I am a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee. Of the hope and resurrection of the dead I am called in question. And when he had also said, there arose a dissension between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the multitude was divided. For the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, neither angel nor spirit, but the Pharisees confess both. And there arose a great cry, and the scribes, where that were of the Pharisees, heart arose and strove, saying, We find no evil in this man, but if a spirit or an angel hath spoken to him, let us not fight against God. And then there arose a great dissension. The chief captain, fearing lest Paul should have been pulled in pieces of them, commanded the soldiers to go down and take him by force from among them, and to bring him into the council. And the night following, the Lord stood by him and said, Be of good cheer, Paul. For as thou hast testified of me in Jerusalem, so must thou bear witness
Shabbat Shalom. Let's take a moment. I have some commentary on that. But let's take a moment for Eduardo. He had to leave again because, from what I'm hearing, they had to reintubate his wife, who's been in ICU, okay, for over a week now. And so let's just take a moment and pray. Father God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Lord, we just come before you, O Lord, and know that you are a healing God, O Heavenly Father. We ask you to stretch forth your hand and heal, O Heavenly Father. Heal in the mighty name of Yeshua HaMashiach, we pray. Amen and amen. I wanted to go over this, go back to Acts chapter 23. Great Torah portion. Okay, in that Paul, we know that Paul really meant, oh no, you can stay because I'm, okay. Paul really meant that the law has been done away with here. That's what he's teaching, right? Okay, we can clearly, very clearly see that Paul, who we all can admit was saved, really, really came against the Torah in this particular portion. Can we all agree upon that? That's one of those alternative facts, okay? Paul being against Torah is an alternative fact. Yes. Because here we see Paul being obedient, okay, and teaching Torah. However, this is an absolutely perfect set of scriptures as to why we study the Bible also culturally. Because what is this teaching you? All right, let's go down to... verse number 6. But when Paul perceived that one part were Sadducees, the other Pharisees, he cried out in the council, "Men, brethren, I am a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee, of the hope and resurrection of the dead. I am called in question." And that's when all hell started breaking out. Okay. It's just like, I am a Democrat, I am a Republican, yes. Okay? But he goes on to say, "And when he has said, there arose a dissension between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the multitude was divided." See, at one point they were unified, but when Paul perceived, okay, that they were Pharisees and Sadducees mixed, he knew exactly what he had to say, okay, to cause that division. The Bible is clear. Verse 8, "For the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection." So, when you talk about Yeshua being resurrected, you know who wasn't going to believe. See, when people say the Jews didn't believe, there were sects of Jews who didn't believe in the resurrection, and those were the Sadducees. They also said neither angel nor spirit, but the Pharisees professed both. So who were most of the believers in the resurrection of Yeshua? They were Pharisees. Okay, they were Pharisees. And that's very important, because when you now go back through the Gospels and you see certain Yeshua saying certain things, and then there is a dissension among the Jews, the church would have you lump all of the Jews into one bowl. However, Yeshua, once again, being part of the culture, knew that there were certain things the Pharisees believed, certain things the Sadducees believed. So very often, you could tell who was in the crowd if you understood what he was saying and what they believed. When he talked about, "I am the resurrection," oh no, there won't be problems with that, because we don't believe if he's in with the Sadducees. Now, remember, most of the people in the temple were Sadducees during that time. So that's one reason why he had so many difficulties. All right? And you need to understand that. Because if you don't, you'll look and people can tell you anything. We bought so many lies. I'm sorry. We bought so many lies about the New Testament and the Torah, and we believe them wholeheartedly. And now we're coming around to see that they were alternative facts. But an alternative fact is a lie. Okay, it is a lie. All right, so we see that Paul, once again, did this on purpose. Now, let's continue in verse number 12. And it was day, and when it was day, a certain of Jews banded together and bound themselves under a curse, bound themselves under a vow, saying that they would neither eat nor drink till they had killed Paul. Well, I guess they died of starvation. Yeah. Okay, because he didn't die until years later. All right? You understand why God says don't make any foolish vows? Mm-hmm. All right? And there were more than 40 which made this conspiracy. And they came to the chief priests and elders and said, we have bound ourselves under a great curse that we will eat nothing until we have slain Paul. Now, remember the chief priest was a Sadducee. So do you think they found some sympathy for their cause within the temple that was run by the Sadducees against Paul? Yes. Okay. Then he goes on. Now therefore ye with the council signify to the chief captain that he must bring him down to you tomorrow. So what are they doing? They are plotting and conspiring to murder a man.
Wait a minute.
Okay.
Not murder.
Okay. Yeah, right. All right. They're going to murder this person, but who are they conspiring to do this murder with? The priest, the church, in God's house. They're in God's house. Do you understand why I say, do you see how far they had gotten away from God? Mm-hmm. Do you see how everybody calling Jesus or calling Yeshua or calling Yahweh is not saved? Right in God's house. They are, okay, binding themselves with a curse, conspiring to kill and shed innocent blood. All right? As he would inquire something more perfectly concerning him, and we, or ever he come near, are ready to kill him. Now, remember, when there was a matter too hard for law, they were supposed to go where? To the chief priest, to the elders, and make a determination. And whatever determination those elders made, guess what? That was so. Now, understand, they gave them permission. Mm-hmm. Okay, permission to do that. Thank God for Paul's sister's son. Okay, heard of it, told them. Okay, but once again, remember, in verse 11, what did God say? Oh, you've testified for me in Jerusalem, but you have to bear witness in Rome. So guess what? God's purpose for him was to get in Rome. And when God gives you a word, no devil in hell, no plot, no curse is going to come against and defeat God's word. You need to understand that. This is a very powerful lesson, okay, to teach you about spiritual warfare, you know, which is going to kind of bring me into this week's Torah portion and what I'm going to be teaching. I bet you a bunch of you got emails and everything else last night, okay, about the prayers that were going on, okay, because there was this bunch of witches that were about to cast spells over President Trump, okay, and so everybody was getting together to pray at midnight, and they were going to come against these witches, and I cannot tell you the number of texts and the emails that I got. Some I responded to, some I didn't, okay? One I responded to and said, they need to be praying for him to get saved, okay? But the whole thing is, I keep telling people, you guys forget where God brought me from. So I'm trying to figure out who's the witch that set up the prayer. Because the dimensions they set up the prayer and the times they set up the prayer were incorrect times for witches to be praying. Okay? And so what they don't realize is that there's going to be blowback on them because of that. Because whoever organized the prayer was probably the witch. Because it was after their prayer that witches would pray. So if I know what you pray, I know how to petition God. See, God will give you enough information to know how to pray. And we went over this Thursday, if anyone was online, okay, about the prophecy, about how all of those rulers and everything were under the spirit of what did Jeremiah say? The prophets were teaching and they were under the spirit of divination and witchcraft and everything. God said, I did not call them to do that. We're going to go over, okay, a lot of that today. You know, but thank you for that sneeze. All right. You know, but this is a very serious time. Because here's what the problem is, Lena. The problem is God also gave the command in Jeremiah, don't pray for them people. You understand? There's going to be some serious things that I'm already hearing about serious things that happen. People do not understand spiritual warfare. They do not understand that the enemy is not an independent doer. He is an independent thinker, but he does nothing without the permission of God. Not only that, but a curse causeless cannot prosper. It won't prosper. Okay, so people do not understand that what you may be praying may go forth and come back and hit you. Okay, because when you pray out of the wrongness of a heart instead of the righteousness of a heart, that prayer will come back and hit you. And guess what? That's what the witches wanted. They wanted you to empower the words of God because they knew how to direct them based upon what was in your heart during that prayer. Very serious. And one day I really have to, I kind of shy away from teaching about things like that because I'll be quite frank, y'all ain't ready for it. You really aren't ready for that kind of level of warfare. And you get out there, it's just like handing a three-year-old the keys to your car and then praying that he can make it out the driveway without getting somebody killed. You know, you don't put get in the car with someone you know is drunk, right? Because you know there's a possibility for you to get hurt. So there are certain things that people are praying right now, which are technically witchcraft prayers. Today's Torah portion was very clear, if you remember, thou shalt not permit a witch to live. Okay, only word that I have for a witch is die. Because that's what the word of God says. So we need to be careful when we are praying. God commands us to do what? Not revile any leaders. It doesn't mean that it has to be the leader we agree with or whether we don't agree with them. Because guess what? If we didn't, one thing I said to somebody, which is probably why they all got mad at me, was that whatever you prayed for the previous president is what you need to be praying for this one. And so when people get angry, it's like, why are you angry? Didn't you pray blessings on him also? Because whatever God sees, the hypocrisy, but the enemy, both God and the devil, hate a hypocrite. Always understand that, and he will use you to do his work. The reason why is because you carry an anointing upon you. That's why the enemy will always choose to work with those who God has anointed. He did it with Ahab, with Micaiah, and 400 prophets of God. Okay, don't think he won't do it today. So we need to be careful because this whole Torah portion this week, a lot of it dealt with how to deal with witchcraft and things like that. So there is no accident even that we are from Thursday night to now, these things happening. All right, we need to be careful. That's all I'm saying, careful. That if you cannot pray a blessing, do not pray out of your, and our hearts can be wicked. There are a lot of things going on that have people upset right now. But if you pray the wrong way, it can be a witchcraft prayer and you will subject yourself to the penalty that is incurred in this word. So I'm just giving a word of caution. Lena, you're next.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
I'll be reading from the Tanakh, page 988, Jeremiah chapter 34, verses 8. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord after King Zedekiah had made a covenant with all the people in Jerusalem to proclaim a release among them, that everyone should set free his Hebrew slaves, both male and female, and that no one should keep his fellow Judean enslaved. Verse 10, everyone, officials and people who had entered into the covenant agreed to set their male and female slaves free and not keep them enslaved any longer. They complied and let them go. But afterwards, they turned about and brought back the men and women they had set free and forced them into slavery again. Mm-hmm. Verse 12. Then it was that the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Verse 13. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I made a covenant with your fathers when I brought them out of the land of Egypt, the house of bondage, saying, in the seventh year, each of you must let go any fellow Hebrew who may be sold to you. When he has served you 6 years, you must set him free. But your fathers would not obey me or give ear. Lately you turned about and did what is proper in my sight, and each of you proclaimed a release to his countrymen, and you made a covenant accordingly before me in the house which bears my name. Verse 16. But now you have turned back and have profaned my name. Each of you has brought back the men and women whom you have given their freedom and forced them to be your slave again. Assuredly, thus says the Lord, you would not obey me and proclaim a release each to his kinsmen and countrymen. Lo, I proclaim your release, declares the Lord, to the sword, to pestilence, and to famine, and I will make you a whore to all the kingdoms of the earth. I will make the men who violated my covenant, who did not fulfill the terms of the covenant which they made before me, like the calf which they cut in two so as to pass between the halves. Verse 19. The officers of Judah and Jerusalem, the officials, the priests, and all the people of the land who pass between the halves of the calf shall be handed over to their enemies, to those who seek to kill them. Their carcasses shall become food for the birds of the sky and the beasts of the earth. I will hand over King Zedekiah of Judah and his officers to their enemies who seek to kill them, to the army of the king of Babylon, which has withdrawn from you. I hereby give the command, declares the Lord, by which I will bring back against the city. They shall attack it and capture it and burn it down. I will make the towns of Judah a desolation without inhabitants. End of the reading. Renee?
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Hallelujah. Grace versus law. This week's Torah portion contains a lot of law. Exodus chapter 21 through 23 reads like an ancient legal code. Of the 613 commandments that the sages traditionally derived from the Torah, more than 50 of them are found in this week's portion. For some reason, many Christian teachers seem to view the laws of the Torah as if they are a bad thing. It is commonly taught that the law is the opposite of grace. You might hear someone say, we are no longer under the law, we are under grace. Implication is that since we have received the Messiah, we need not concern ourselves with the laws in the Old Testament. We can call this idea grace versus law. Let's think about the grace versus law idea. What do we mean when we say that we are not under the law? Does that mean we do not have to keep God's rules? For example, does it mean that we can commit adultery and theft? Of course not. No one would say that, but what does it mean? The grace versus law concept is derived from the writings of Paul. In his epistles, it seems that Paul puts the two in opposition to each other. He often says things like, before faith came, we were kept in custody under the law. Galatians, the 3rd chapter, verse 23. And if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Galatians 5, verse 18. One might misunderstand these statements to mean that Christians do not need to keep God's rules. Of course, that would be absurd. Paul realized that some people might misunderstand his teaching, but he cautioned us not to suppose that grace gives us free license to sin against God. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? Romans, the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 2. Do we then nullify the law through faith? May it never be. On the contrary, we establish the law, Romans 3, verse 31. If Paul was not teaching believers that they did not have to keep God's rules, what was he talking about? In Paul's day, many of the Jewish believers taught that before Gentiles could be part of the kingdom of heaven, they needed to become Jewish. The idea that a Gentile must become Jewish before being saved is what Paul calls being under the law. Paul believed that Gentiles became sons of Abraham and part of the people of God through faith in Messiah. They did not need to earn that status by becoming legally Jewish. They did not need to first come under the law in order to enter the kingdom. The Bible does not actually teach the idea of grace versus law. Grace is God's free gift of salvation for those who believe in his Son. Law is his loving instruction for how his people should live. Grace versus law is a false dichotomy. They are not opposed to each other. They are meant to work hand in hand. Hallelujah. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Going over this, and I'm going to read the right the wrong also. Okay, one thing you need to understand. Let's go to 2 Peter chapter 3 for a moment. 2 Peter chapter 3. Let's hear what Peter says about Paul. All right, important for us to understand, okay, this and lay this foundation. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 15. And account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written to you. Continue reading. As also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest. That word rest means to twist. As they do also other scriptures unto their own destruction. Okay. So, then he goes on saying, ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with what? The error of who? All right, so to lead away, to even, first of all, we need to understand. He said those that are unlearned and unstable would twist what Paul said. Oh, they graduated this Bible college and they got a doctor before their name and a FUD, PhD, okay, after their name. Unlearned and unstable. Stable would twist the scriptures, as they also do what other scriptures to what? Their own destruction. You know what the sad part is? They're going to take a whole lot of people with them. You understand? But he also goes on to talk about, beware lest you also be led away with the error of the wicked. So twisting what Paul says to come up with something that is contrary to what the Word of God says, he says, is the error of the wicked. Very important to understand. And what Renee read here about the grace once again, it was a case where for a time, some of the Jews and the proselytes who were, I'll say, converted to Judaism, believed that when the gospel opened up to the Gentiles, they first had to become a Jew, and then. So let's see that. Let's go to Acts chapter 15. Acts chapter 15, then we're also going to go to the book of Galatians. In Acts chapter 15, we see verse 1. And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. All right? So when Paul comes against that, first of all, Torah never had anything to do with salvation. There is salvation in none other than Yeshua HaMashiach, which is why when John saw Yeshua, he pronounced upon him, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Were they sacrificing lambs as sin offerings prior to Yeshua? Well, every single lamb that was sacrificed was pointing towards Yeshua. And God is very clear in the book of Leviticus that when they sacrificed that lamb and that lamb died, they were forgiven. Why? Because the lamb was in proxy of Yeshua HaMashiach. For how long? Before the foundation of the world, the lamb was slain. So it was never not about Yeshua. Okay, we have this arrogance. The church has an arrogance to think that they are the only ones that are saved. However, with Yeshua now, we have no temple. So the only way to be saved is to confess that what His death did. His death as the Lamb of God. If you do not recognize him as being the only type of sacrifice that can take away your sin, you have no other alternatives. It has always been about Yeshua, and it will always be about Yeshua. There is salvation in none other than Yeshua. You see, so you can follow all the Torah. The Torah does not make you saved. Sorry, the Torah is what you do when you recognize you are saved. You can't even understand some of this self unless you are. And by saved, I mean what? The old man passes away. The new man, you have a new man. You've been given a new heart. Because if you try to approach the Torah with an old man, an old heart, it becomes a burdensome stone. The Torah was only meant to be a terror to the wicked. Why? Because it exposes what sin is, and the penalty for sin is death. You see, so going to always remember that Acts chapter 15 was the Jerusalem Council. It is at Acts chapter 15 that they put this whole thing to rest about the circumcision. So therefore, in understanding Paul wrote part of Galatians prior to Acts 15. He writes the rest of Galatians after Acts 15. And in Acts 15, okay, let's go to verse number 19, or rather 18. Okay. Tell you what, let's go to verse 13. Okay, verse 13. And after they had held their peace, James answered, saying, men and brethren, hearken unto me. Simeon hath declared, Simeon is Peter, hath declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. Who was that? I want you to think about that. Who did God visit to take a people for his name? Who was the first one?
Abraham.
Okay, Abraham. And to this degree, the words of the prophets as it is written, after this I will return and again build the tabernacle of David, which is fallen down, and I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up, that the residue of man, might seek after the Lord or after Yahweh and all the Gentiles upon whom my name is called, saith Yahweh, who doeth all these things. Known unto God. Now, I want you to think about it. Israel, he called as a nation, right? Everyone prior to that, okay, you have Israel. Everyone prior to that, remember, the original one called for his purpose and given a name or empowered by him was Adam. After the, once again, that incident in the garden, okay, that little incident in the garden, we have been striving ever since then to get back in the garden. We tried it, and then with Noah, guess what? We had another opportunity. That went south really fast. Then there's the call to Abraham and given the promise to Abraham, which eventually we see the fulfillment in Israel, where he chooses Israel as his son. And Israel, once again, we are Israelites through what? Faith in Yeshua. All right, so he goes, known unto God are all the works from the beginning of the world. Wherefore, my sentence is that we trouble not them which are among the Gentiles are turned to God. How many gods are they? There's only one. But that we write unto them that they abstain from the pollutions of idols and from fornication and from things strangled and from blood. Now, let me ask you something. Is that part of the written law or the oral law? That's the written law. It's in the written law. See, what was troubling everybody was what? The traditions of the elders, which was the oral law, which is what they got in trouble for. So what does James point them to? First, in order to, we got to clean them up. So we will tell them that they abstain from pollutions of idols, fornication, things strangled, from blood. That's all in the book of Leviticus, guys. For Moses of old times, hath in every city them that preach him, being read in the synagogues every Sabbath day. So what is he leading the Gentiles to? The synagogues on the Sabbath day were what? Moses' oral or written? It's the written. Come on. Let's get fast there. Stop thinking about it. You should know this by now. Okay. All right. Moses is the written law. So what were they that had come to God to be directed towards? The written, not the oral, the written. So don't trouble them with all of the traditions like the washing of pots and all that kind of stuff. Give them the written, and they'll get the written when they go to the synagogue on the Sabbath day where Moses is read. Now, he begins them saying, these are the first things that you do with them, because that was needed in order for them to have fellowship with the Jews. Remember, they were idolaters. They would bring their idols, okay, they would be doing inappropriate sexual practices as parts of worship. No, you can't mix that together. So give them these four corners, the rest of it they're going to learn as they come to the synagogue on the Sabbath day and where the written Torah is read. Okay, so we see that. After that, you see Paul go into the book of Galatians. All right? Now, Galatians, he's talking to Gentiles. Let's go to chapter 3. Oh, foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Yeshua HaMashiach hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? So, what was happening? They all came to Christ through faith in Yeshua first. Then here come these Judaizers saying, y'all ain't saved. You need to do this, you need to do this, you need to do that. And so he says, who bewitched you? Guess what? It's the same spirit today. The same spirit today. People come out of the church, go into a messianic congregation. Next thing you know, they're wearing kippah, tzitzit, all of these kind of different things. Okay? And thinking, now I finally reached it. I'm finally saved. That didn't make you saved. Your faith in Yeshua made you saved. God's mercy leads you to Torah because you're saved. You understand what I'm saying? Because you are saved, because you have a heart towards Him, He will lead you into the Torah. And then from that point on, it's up to you. Let's go to verse number 19 of Galatians 3. Wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgressions. People were sinning. What does the law do? It defines sin. The Torah defines sin. The Torah defines the penalty of sin. You want to know why the Torah is so important in a believer's life? Because of the very definition of its ability to define sin. Without Torah, you do not know what God calls sin. So if you don't have Torah, you have no sin. If you have no sin, you don't need a savior. Hello? You understand the danger of saying we have done away with the law? Because now you've said you've done away with the very law of God that He uses to define sin. So therefore, guess what? The penalty for sin is death. However, forgiveness of sin is also included in that. You have no way back. All right, so he goes on to say, it was added because of transgressions till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, and it was ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator. Now, a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. Think about that. This week's Torah portion in Exodus 23, what do we have? I send my angel. Well, that's a very special angel, guys. It's not just a regular angel. His name is in that angel, and he has the ability to forgive sin. Who do you think was walking in the midst of his Yeshua? Okay. Now, anyway, is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid. For if there had been a law given which would have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. But the scripture has concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Yeshua HaMashiach might be given to them that believe. But before faith, we were kept under the law. Why? You were kept under the law because you had to go sacrifice a lamb for your sin. You had to physically sacrifice a lamb for your sin. But now, because of Yeshua, you confess Him as the Lamb of God that has taken away your sin. You confess your sin. Then you confess that Yeshua HaMashiach is the Lamb of God to take away that sin, and accept His shed blood for your life, and you are saved. You understand what I'm saying? So this is what he's talking about. And shut up faith, which should afterwards be relieved. For the law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. Now, the church interprets that you do not need the law after that. Guess what? A schoolmaster teaches you 1 plus 1 equals 2, 2 plus 2 equals 3. After I graduate school, do I still need 1 plus 1 equals 1, 1 plus 1 equals 2? I still need that. Everything I do is based upon what? Math or spelling. Let me tell you, the things you taught the schoolmaster that they taught you in first grade. Listen, in what was it? Nursery school. Nursery school, they taught Gracie her ABCs. When she gets older, does she forget that? No, she still needs it. Okay? The difference now is that if I'm grown up, I shouldn't have to go for timeouts because I'm misbehaving in class. You understand? That's what a schoolmaster does. A schoolmaster disciplines you as a child, but when you grow up, you don't need that schoolmaster following you to discipline you. You don't need the schoolmaster to lead you to the principal's office because you violated the Torah. If you've learned the lessons, the schoolmaster who has taught you always remains with you. I don't need that anymore because I'm not sinning. You understand what I'm saying? I learned the lessons. Okay. And so anyway, he goes on to say, but after faith has come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster, for ye are all the children of God by faith in Yeshua HaMashiach. Okay? So, as children, children need someone to teach them right from wrong. Children need to learn lessons. That's why we send them to school. But there comes a time when a child graduates school and has to take the lessons they learned in school and apply them to their life, right? What would happen if you had every single one of your teachers following you? Okay, that would be crazy. But when you graduated, guess what? You leave those teachers behind and you walk in the lessons they taught you. And that's the example that Paul is trying to give, okay, with this, all right? Okay, let's go to right the wrong. You know, when I read Parashah Mishpatim, I was reminded of what Yahweh told B'nai Israel, the children of Israel, in Deuteronomy 4:7. For what nation is there so great who hath God so nigh unto them as Yahweh our God or Elohim is in all things that we call upon him for? And what nation is there so great that hath statutes, judgments, so righteous as all this law which I set before you this day? Stop right there. Thank you, Lord. So, when they look at what laws you follow and what commandments you obey, who does it point to? It points to Yahweh, right? So do you wonder why, okay, the radical Muslims want to put us under Sharia law? Because what would that law point to based upon this principle? Their God. You keep on just not understanding. This is all about God. Yes. You understand what I'm saying? This is not about the things that you being taught. This is all about one nation under God and who that God is going to be. And that's what the intention of this is, that other nations will look at what you do and how well you are, and it will glorify God. So the enemy wants to come in, simply change the religious laws that will point towards their God. Okay, now, foolish Americans. Foolish Americans. We're so concentrating on Islam, but do you think he's happy with all the Hindu gods we have over here? Do you think he's happy with Buddha? Foolish, foolish, an idol is an idol. If it is any other God than him, okay, it places us under a ban. Thou shalt have no other gods. It doesn't matter who it is. No other gods means no other gods. Okay? If you could, there would be Hindu temples. You see them popping up now. You see a lot of Hindu temples popping up. You see a lot of Buddhist places popping up. But the enemy has us so focused on one that we don't see what he's doing all around. Okay? We want our religious freedoms. And next thing you know, you got Wiccans. So who did they use to get that? They couldn't do it before. Who did they use to get their freedom? They used the Christians. Because the law of unintended consequences says, if you allow one, you must allow them all. Okay? Foolish, foolish Americans. Okay, truly no other nation on the face of the earth had the privilege of receiving its laws and judicial system direct from God. One of the points that stuck me in Parasha Mashpatim is how God expects us to make restitution when we break one of his rulings. Exodus 21:33. If an ish, a man, opens a pit, or if a man digs a pit and doesn't cover it, and a bull or a donkey falls into it, the owner of the pit shall make it good. He shall give money to its owner, and the dead animal shall be his. Chapter 22, verse 1. If a man steals an ox or a sheep and kills it and sells it, he shall pay 5 oxen for an ox and 4 sheep for a sheep. 22:5. If a man causes a field or vineyard to be eaten and lets his animals loose and it grazes in another man's field, he shall make a restitution from the best of his own field and from the best of his own vineyard. Verse 6. If fire breaks out and catches in thorns so that the shocks of grain or the standing grain or the field are consumed, he who kindled the fire shall surely make restitution. I could go on quoting more verses, but we will probably end up having to read the entire parasha. Mm. The point is, God expects those who break his laws and commandments to make restitution. Restitution is part of the restoration process. Without it, I believe restoration of a sinner is incomplete. It is not enough for us to just apologize when we sin against our fellow man, nor is it enough for us to simply ask forgiveness. We need to make restitution in order to complete the restoration process. Many believers think that after sinning against someone, they are absolved from guilt by simply confessing their sin. But that is not what God is telling us here in Parasha Mishpatim. If we have wronged someone, whether it be a relative, a friend, a neighbor, an employee, a boss, or the government, we need to not only apologize, whether publicly or privately, we need to make every effort to right the wrong that we've done by making restitution. There is one very practical example of what I have encountered as a cause for restitution. It comes straight from this week's parasha, and I'm sure it is something we can relate to. If a man borrows anything of his neighbor's and it is injured or dies, the owner of it not being with it, he shall surely make restitution. How many times have you borrowed something from a friend or neighbor and it broke or was damaged while in your possession? It was not enough when you said, "I'm sorry, it wasn't my fault." You need to right the wrong by paying for the damages or replacing what you borrowed. If you have cheated, stole, lied, it is not enough for you to fall on your face and ask forgiveness of the Lord. You need to also do what? Make restitution. I cannot tell you how many times someone has come to me and confessed a sin, but for one reason or another, they were reluctant to right the wrong by going back to whoever they wronged and make restitution. Perhaps it was their pride, or possibly it would have caused them embarrassment or personal pain and expense. So instead of making restitution, they justified in their own mind that they were absolved simply by confessing to me and asking God for forgiveness. Well, God is telling us here, this is not the case. The sin is not resolved until the restitution is made. You understand that? Some people don't understand. You can confess all you want until you make the appropriate restitution. Guess what? The realm of death, for lack of a better word right now, will continue. Yes, God has mercy. So maybe he'll slow some things down. The problem is, you have to make restitution. What if the sin is directly against God? Ooh, that's a problem. Okay, no ifs, ands, or buts about making. You can't just say you're sorry. Restitution has to be made. Matthew 5:23. Therefore, if you bring your korban or sacrifice to the altar, and there you remember that your brother in the Lord has something against you, leave your sacrifice or korban there before the altar, and go and first be reconciled to your brother, and then come offer your sacrifice. Come to terms quickly with your opponent in a lawsuit. Boy, why did we say that as soon as the lawyer walks in? Come to terms quickly with your... You thought you were going to slide in. All right. Come to terms quickly with your opponent in a lawsuit while you are a fellow traveler on the way to the promised land, lest the opponent might deliver you to the shofet, the judge, and the judge might deliver you to the soter, or law official, and the law official might deliver you to the Bet HaSoar, prison house. For men, truly I say to you, you may never come out from there until you repay the last peruta, okay, or a small coin. Go for a moment to Matthew chapter 18. He teaches that, okay, in Matthew, what was that, Matthew 5? Okay, but Matthew chapter 18, let's see how serious he is about this. Very, very serious. Okay, in Matthew chapter 18, verse number 21, if you have the keyword study Bible, it says forgiving others. So he talks about, once again, they ask him a question. If my brother sins against me, how many times do I have to, forgive him? All right, what if he sins against me seven times? Do I have to forgive him seven times? And Yeshua says, okay, until 70 times seven. And I think Luke, they respond, oh Lord, increase our faith. But then he goes on to talk about the kingdom of heaven is like. In other words, whenever you see that, this is how the kingdom is operating. Whenever you see in the parables the kingdom of God is like, or the kingdom of heaven is like, this is how it's operating right now. So we go from story form into actual form using a case study as an example. This is a case study. So, you know, there was a king that would take account of his servants. All right? When does Yeshua take account of his servants? Okay, that end year where we go up to tabernacles and all of that, when each of us are brought before him. So what is he teaching you? Number one, he's teaching you a time is coming when you are going to have to make a personal appearance before the king, and he is going to take account of what you have done. First thing. Number two, in verse 24, and when he had begun to reckon, one was brought to him which owed him 10,000 talents. That is just like the reverse of you winning the Powerball. Okay, lottery. Instead of you winning the money, if you have the ticket, you're the one that has to pay it. That's how much that is. For so as much as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and children, and all that he had, payment to be made. Now, in reading this, do you see this week's Torah portion? Okay, this week's Torah portion is in this. Okay, right here. Okay, because that's how, once again, they handle. Slavery wasn't slavery as we in America later defined it. It was that if you had a debt and you could not pay that debt, you sold yourself to work off that debt, but you could only work for that for what, 6 years, and the seventh year you went free. Okay, seventh year you went free. Do you think it's amazing that credit on the credit bureaus, things stay for 7 years and then they drop off? Bankruptcy laws, 7 years and then they drop off. Okay, 7 years, 14 years, sets of seven for some of them, and then they drop off. However, what is he telling you here? Your debt not only affects you and your family, but your children, which is what? Future generations. So you're not only selling yourself into bondage, you're selling your wife into bondage. You're selling your children. So your children will be working very hard until your original debt. So it's not just their debt that they get into, they're going to be working to pay your debt off also. Mm-hmm. So debt is a family thing, which is another reason why next week I'm saying we're bringing somebody in here because, look, it's time to get out of Egypt, okay, and be able to make it, okay, the way we need to. Okay, and so he goes, and all that he had and payment had to be made. So it not only cost him, his wife, his children, but everything else he had worked for. He would have lost his home. He would have lost his car. He would have lost everything. And after he gave everything he had worked for all those years, he still had to work. All right. The servant therefore fell down. Number one, he fell down and worshiped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. Okay? And the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him and forgave him the debt. Wow. See, never get so arrogant that you cannot fall down and say, Lord, I made a mistake. I made a mistake. This penalty is greater. Greater than what I can bear. My children are suffering because of my disobedience. My grandchildren, okay, my all those associated with me, forgive me. And it says the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him, and guess what? Forgave him. Not only he forgave him that debt, he got to keep all of his stuff. Okay? But the same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence. And he laid his hands on him, and he took him by the throat, saying, pay me that thou owest. And the fellow servant did what? Fell down, besought him, saying, have patience with me. I will pay thee all. Does that sound familiar? Okay. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison. So the same mercy that had been just given him, he refused to give it to someone else. What goes around, guys, comes around. Good title. What goes around, comes around. All right? So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry and came and told unto their Lord all that was done. See, this is a problem because people will see us worshiping and doing all of that stuff and then get out and see us on Monday being the biggest demon in hell. Okay, not realizing that that is being observed by the king. When you grieve someone like that and they go before God, then what goes around comes around. Okay, he goes on to say, verse 32, then his Lord, after he had called him and said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt. Why? Because you desired me to. You needed me to do that. All right. Should you not also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? What is the lesson to learn here? The greatest testimony. God will give you a testimony and then test you. He'll bring somebody in your path that had the same problem. What are you going to do with that person? Mm-hmm. Don't do the right thing, and guess what? You'll be back in that same position again. You understand what I'm saying? Okay, sometimes people don't understand why certain things happen the way that they do, but what goes around will come around again. Now, this is the key. I like this. And his Lord was wroth and did what? Delivered him to the tormentors. Who do you think the tormentor is? What's his name? Hasatan. Hasatan. Until he should pay all that was due him. Wait a minute. But the debt was so great, he couldn't pay it. So we're back to square one. Not only him, but his wife. And his children, and all they lost, everything. Now, the tormentor, think about the tormentor. The tormentor chooses the weapons of torment, you know. Think about unforgiveness. You think diabetes is a tormentor? Yeah. Do you think cancer is a tormentor?
Yes.
Okay? I think hot flashes are a tormentor.
Yes.
Okay. But the key is the tormentor chooses the torment. Now, here is the principle that takes us out of parable into today. February, what, 25th is it? 25th, 2017. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do unto you, if you from your hearts forgive not everyone his brother their trespasses. So guess what? You have unforgiveness. You just can't get over perceived wrongs. You just keep on bringing it up. You keep on making everybody torment. And guess what he says? All right? My heavenly Father will do unto you. In other words, the debt that you thought was forgiven is no longer forgiven. Forget about this once saved, always saved. Oh, that's hard for people, but guess what? Do you have a red letter Bible? And it's not me speaking it then. You understand? He says, that's exactly what will happen to you if you don't forgive. How dare we be so arrogant to think that God's going to forgive me, but I don't have to forgive anyone else, and I'll still be saved, and they're going to hell. Doesn't work that way. The forgiveness you have in your heart for others is the forgiveness that you will receive from God. Hello. All right? Anybody got aught against anybody? Go get it right. Okay, go get it right. All right, because forgive them. Okay, it could be for anything that is done. Forgiveness is not about you, or about them rather. It's about you once again, not willing to pay the penalty for your unforgiveness. As long as you insist upon them being in hell, you are going to be there with them. Okay, and eventually it can get to eternity. All right. There's some people I choose not to be in the lake of fire with. Okay. So anyway, we see that principle there. Ed, if you would come up and read the last article, then we'll get to our lesson.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Listen to my voice. Shema B'Kolai. Exodus 21, 1 through 24, 18, Jeremiah 34, 8 through 22, and 33, 25 through 26, and Matthew 5, 38 through 42. Exodus 23, 20, Behold, I sent my angel before you to keep you by the way and to bring you into the place which I have prepared. Pay attention to him. Listen to his voice. Don't provoke him, for he will not pardon your disobedience, for my name is in him. But if you indeed listen to his voice and do all that I speak, then I will be an enemy to your enemies and an adversary to your adversaries. In the midst of the Mishpatim, Yahweh has given this week's parasha. Is this significant and powerful Mishpat a judgment about his angel? In order to understand who this angel is, I would like to explain the Hebrew word kol, translated in our passage above, voice. We first encountered the word kol in last week's parasha, when Moses was told, listen to the voice of his father Yitro, Jethro, Shemot 18:24. The next time we saw the word in Parashah Yitro was when Yahweh gave the brief grade to Bnei Israel, children of Israel, the following message from God. Exodus 19:5. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my grit of covenant, then you shall be my possession from among all peoples, for all the earth is mine. So from these two uses of the word kol, we see that the word voice, as used in the Hebraic, is idiomatic for obedience. But more than that, the word kol is also idiomatic for the word memra in the Aramaic onkulosis targum. The voice of God is the word of God. That was a huge implication when applied to Yahweh, who's saying to us in the introductory passage above in Parsha Mishpatim. Think of what we've been told in the passage. Yahweh will be sending his special angel with Israel to first keep, from the Hebrew word root shamar, which can mean to restrict from certain boundaries, them by the way, and to second, to bring them into the place he prepared for them. Then they're told to pay attention to this angel. In Hebrew, the word malak, angel, can also be translated as messengers. to listen to his voice, not to provoke him, for he will not pardon their disobedience. Why? Because Yahweh's name is in him. Some translations say that he bears Yahweh's name. However, the children of Israel are told that if they do not listen to this angel's voice, Yahweh will be an enemy to their enemies. I'm sorry that if they do listen to this voice, Yahweh's enemy will be an enemy to their enemies. There must be one very special angel, and let us take a look at why. First of all, as I understand the passage, this angel will keep the children of Israel with certain boundaries while they're on their way by his voice. As we discussed earlier, kol, a voice, is the same as saying his word. Therefore, what is being said here is that the word of this angel would be the boundaries of the children of Israel would be restricted to. However, from the Brit Hadashah, Renewed Covenant, we know that the angels are not sent by Yahweh to boss us around, nor are they sent to keep us within certain boundaries, but rather they are sent to minister to us, not to interfere with us. Speaking of angels, the writer of Hebrews tells us, Hebrews 1:14, are they not all ministering spirits, sent forth to minister for them who should be the heirs of salvation? In contrast, this particular angel's ministering as spoken in Parsha Mishpatim will be intrusive on the lives of the people. Secondly, we're told that this angel's voice, if not a healer, he will not pardon the offender's disobedience. From what we know of angels, we find once and again characteristics that are not very angel-like. Why? Because the word this angel will speak will be law, and if not adhered to, will result in punishment. He will not forgive their disobedience. Nowhere in Scripture are we told, even given the impression, that an angel can speak laws or forgive sin. Only God can do that. The third thing we are being told about this angel is that he bears the name of Yahweh. This is one of the most amazing statements found in Torah. Angels are created beings. As we learn from past Torah commentaries, the name of Yahweh represents his character. God's name is his character. Therefore, we're being told that this angel will not just do great and mighty things as acting in the name of God, nor will he just do great and mighty things by the power of God, as others have done in Scripture, like Moses, but he will actually have the whole nature and essence of God, Yud, He, Vav, He. Certainly the implication here of this angel is divinity. Another amazing thing that we found in this parasha, Mishpatim, is from the following passage, Exodus 24:9. Then Moses, Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and 70 of the elders went up, and they saw the God of Israel. Under his feet was like a paved work of sapphire stone, like the skies for clearness. And he did lay his hand on the nobles of the children of Israel. They saw God and ate and drank. Now this passage has been translated in traditional Jewish Bibles as the 70 elders not seeing God but worshiping God. It has also been explained by Jewish sages that this was merely a vision the elders were having and not a visual experience. Let us look into these two explanations. The root Hebrew word used for saw in this passage is yirah, which can be translated as see, observe, appear, gaze, but never worship. In addition, the fact that they saw what was under God's feet, a paved work of sapphire stone, also indicates that the elders were looking and not worshiping. As for a vision, what are the chances that the 70 people would have the same vision at the same time and all see the same thing? Were they all put into a trance? Did they fall asleep at the same time? Highly unlikely. Plus, there is no indication of these possibilities in the passage. A better explanation, and one that will corroborate with what Yahweh told Moses, is that the 70 elders saw the divine angel, pre-incarnate Yeshua, spoken of in verse 23:20. This explanation will also confirm the deity of the angel, thus explaining why he had those supernatural and divine attributes. It will also explain why the elders were able to look upon God and live. Exodus 24:11. He didn't lay his hand on the nobles of the children of Israel. They saw God and ate and drank. Listen to my voice. Shema Kibbutz. Shabbat Shalom.
All right, this week's Torah portion, very important Torah portion. Okay, and that contains a lot of the laws that we have. Ken, you do me a favor, son. Bring me my Tanakh and also my notebook there. All right, thank you. All right. lots of good things with this. Let's go to our Torah portion. Exodus chapter, let's start at 21. Exodus 21, just some highlights, okay, for that. All right. One thing that we need to understand is that these laws, okay, contain what our moral standards are. These laws are laws that apply to who? Us, everybody, okay? Now, our laws are divinely sanctioned laws given to us by our Creator. All right, so what does that mean? They're not going to change, guys. They're not going to change. Okay, they were proclaimed to Israel to apply to them, and because they don't change, they apply to us, and they will apply in the future, because God is the same what? Yesterday, today, and forever. Okay, so when the title of this Torah portion is Mishpatim, the root word of that is judge. So these are the things that we are what? Judging by, but these are the things that we will be judged by. Always remember, whatever manner of judgment you judge with will be the manner that you will be judged with. Okay, so let's start with, and I love this part, okay, verse 2. When you acquire, or rather, verse 1, these are the rules that you shall set before them. When you acquire a Hebrew slave, he shall serve 6 years. In the seventh year, he shall go free without payment. If he came single, he shall leave single. If he had his wife shall leave with him. So, in other words, whatever condition he came to you with is the same condition he leaves with. If he comes to you and he gets married after being with you, he can leave, but his wife would have to stay. Okay? If he came married, you could then, okay, take your wife. If his master gave him a wife and she has borne him children, the wife and her children belong to the master, and he will leave alone. That doesn't sound right fair, does it?
No.
Okay. He would have to do what? Purchase, okay, his children. All right, hello, are we kind of thinking back to Jacob?
Yes.
Okay, can you see? Okay, Jacob came in by himself.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, why do you think he said, I will work for Rachel for 7 years. He wanted to do what? Purchase her. Okay, and then when Laban tricked him, he had to add another 7 years because he had two wives. And then even after that, because he had the concubines and all of that kind of stuff also. And then they had the children. All right, so you understand how we're seeing this law in application here. All right, now he goes on to say, verse 5 is very key. But if the slave declares, I love my master and my wife and my children. I do not wish to go free. His master shall take him before Elohim God. He shall be brought to the door or the doorpost, and his master shall pierce his ear with an awl, and he shall remain his slave for life. All right. This is craziness. Mm-hmm. Let's go to the explanation here. Manumission of indentured servants. That's why I like this particular study Bible, because you can go right and see some opinions here. Biblical law deals with two types of bondsmen, the Israelite or Hebrew slaves, who are really what? Indentured servants, and then those that are full slaves. Hebrew slaves must be freed after 6 years. Full lifelong slavery is in principle limited to foreigners. Okay, and that's in Deuteronomy 15 verses 12 through 18, Leviticus 25 verses 39 through 55. Both types were domestic slaves living in their owners' homes, not members of slave gangs working on plantations. Hello. Okay. biblical law and ethical teachings require humane treatment of slaves based upon the shared humanity of master and servant. Who was that relationship supposed to mirror? Between the slave and the slave owner, or the servant and the master. It was supposed to match, okay, God with us. You understand what I'm saying? All right, so understand something. When you're understanding that, get in part of your mind how America handled slavery. And based upon that, that it was supposed to mirror God's relationship and treatment of his people. What kind of image were we sending? Forcing people into Christianity and then doing what to them? Wow. Wow. Okay, it goes on. When you acquire a Hebrew slave, an indigenous Israelite might indenture himself or a member of his household to obtain support. That's also Leviticus 25, 39, and 47. And a convicted thief who could not make restitution would be sold to raise the money to pay it. Very unlike today, you get caught stealing, you go get three hops and a cop. Okay, and the government pays for it, and the person is still out of their merchandise. So do you see how, even at the basic level, we have a very unjust, unbiblical legal system, a way of handling things? Debtors and members of their households might also be seized to work off defaulted loans. So in other words, actually, bankruptcies were not an option. You still had to pay that back. Okay, you may have had to work, but anyway, it is questionable whether the Torah permits this, but in any case, the present law would have had the effect of limiting debt servitude. In the seventh year, he shall go free. Now, consider bankruptcy. Bankruptcy is given to you by the courts, okay, highest courts. In our reading in Matthew chapter 18, okay, can you see a correlation between someone coming before the court and asking for mercy? And that's right, and they get forgiveness of that debt exactly the way the king did right there. So there is a precedence for that, and it's called mercy. You understand? The law says you're supposed to work it out, but it's always up to the one you owe it to. He can decide to write off the debt. And that is why your debtors will also petition the court and everything for a ruling, you see? And then the judge goes before and makes that determination, okay, standing in the place of the judge, and you are the one requiring mercy. And there are times if everything, they give you mercy, and there are times when maybe you don't get mercy. So after you get that mercy, guess what? Don't go back and do the same thing you did again. Because what are you doing? You're flaunting the mercy of the courts. You didn't learn the lesson. All right? So then, this also states, in the seventh year he shall go free. So to Deuteronomy 15:12. Now, according to the Babylonian laws of Hammurabi, okay, Roth law collections from Mesopotamia and Asia Minor, context of scripture, blah, blah, blah. Debt servants went free after 3 years. So this, a cultural thing, if you go back in culture, which is why I like this, it's giving you something to relate to the law of that land back then. The last sentence there, all Hebrew slaves go free simultaneously in the Jubilee year, no matter how long they have served. Okay, verse 5, the servant might become attached to his master or the family he has established in the master's household, or consider security and subservience preferable to the financial risk of independence. That's a mouthful. Okay, would rather work for somebody than take a chance working for self. Somebody is safe. Okay? working. That's why they always wanted to go back to
Egypt.
Egypt is a place of security. Yes, I realize that Pharaoh's going to kick me in the rear end, but Pharaoh's consistent at least. Okay? He's consistent. Yeah, you know, I know to expect that. I don't know what's going to happen when I leave. So, very often people will rather have the security of something, not give up that security, even if it is not the best thing for them. If you can't change a person's servanthood mindset from being a servant to man to a servant of God, they will always be in slavery. Okay? So anyway, then verse 6, a commentary for verse 6. Bring them before God to the door of the doorpost. Either at the sanctuary needs the near the master's house, or before some symbol of God kept at the master's door. Pierce his ear. This may symbolize the servant's obligation to have his ear permanently open to hear his master's orders. See Deuteronomy 15:17. Permanent attachment to his master's house. You understand that? Need to understand the principles behind that. All right. Oh, I love my boss. I never want to leave. Okay, 45 years later, he kicks you out. All right. But see, a lot of these things we didn't know and we didn't understand. You understand? We bought a system created by man. Now we see a system created by God, and we understand how we were tricked. Okay, we understand how we're tricked, but we also have to understand how we can pray, okay, also with this. All right? Now, we go on to say, the Midrash saw the ceremony as symbolic. The ear which, listen, the ear which heard God say that Israelites are his servants and may not be sold into permanent servitude, Leviticus 25:42, is punished for electing to remain a servant to a human master.
Wow.
Okay? Because God intended upon us to be free. He intended us to be slaves no more. So when that slave chooses to stay with the master rather than go free, it is an affront to his God. So God does what? Here is a physical sign. The blood on the doorpost. What set you free? The blood on the blood of the lamb on the doorpost. You want to stay in bondage? Then your own blood. Okay, on the doorpost will keep you in bondage for life. Guess what? That means not only you, but if you marry, your wife, your children, none of them generational slavery. You're never allowed to leave. You die, your wife dies, your children are still slaves. And their children. And their children. You understand? All right, we saw that in slavery here, where a slave would belong to the master, his children, or whatsoever, until they ended slavery. There are some that are saying now, I read an article, I'm not sure if the school is in Louisiana, okay, but the teacher wanted them to write an article on Black History Month. And one kid was really, really angry, okay, that they had to do that. And they came and said, you know, that child said, you know, it would have been better, their hatred for blacks, they said, I hate them. It would have been better if they were still slaves today. We would be better off. Okay? Guess what? If there hadn't been a civil war and everything that happened with that, who knows? But who knows if the Civil War was not a judgment against America for her, what? Treatment of slaves, because remember what happened. You have the 13 colonies. Then with the Civil War, what happened? You had a divided country. Do you remember? All right. Now, understand one thing. When we go for a moment back to the Torah portion in verse number... Is it around? Okay. Verse number 16. He who kidnaps a man, whether he has sold him or is still holding him, shall be put to death. How were slaves brought over here to America? It was not as, it started out as an indentured servitude, but then it went to going and taking free people, kidnapping them, and bringing them over to this nation. Now, we claim to be one nation under God, am I right? We claim to put the Ten Commandments as the basis of our law, right? Well, if that's the case, you can't take out one and leave the other. So the law states that if you kidnap a man and sold them, you shall be put to death. The New Testament even testifies of that in the book of Revelation. There's a term in the New Testament called men stealers. You get a chance? Okay, look it up. Men stealers. They are those who kidnap people into bondage. We went over that long, long time ago. So both Old Testament and New Testament says a man stealer will be put to death. In the end, a man stealer will be cast into the lake of fire. So I ask you, with the way that we handled slavery, it almost brought about the death of a united country. There were families against families, fighting against families. That was one war held here, American against American, all due to the handling of slaves. The handling of slaves. All right. We need to do a Revelation study, and we're going to go back and do the history of slavery in this country. Why? Because there's a particular time period, 240 years, which is a biblical time period for the handling of slavery. And how God brought down a nation when a nation didn't care that black lives mattered. Come on, let's get real. People get their panties in a wad, okay, about that term. But this nation, once again, what happens if a nation decides to keep free people in bondage? Okay? If we're one nation under God and they cry out to him, guess what? There are penalties to that. So, in that case, I ought to be seeing a nation divided, families fighting against each other. Hello? Almost all out civil war. What goes around?
Comes around.
Okay, comes around again. Okay, so that's important. Okay, to understand. Go down to verse 26. When a man strikes the eye of his slave, male or female, and destroys it, he shall let him go free on account of his eye. If he knocks out the tooth of his slave, male or female, he shall let him go free on account of his tooth. We mutilated slaves. Okay, and yet claim to be one nation under God. Do you, another reason why Islam has such of a stronghold within people of color's community is because these atrocities were committed under the name of Christ. Slaves were brought over, forced into bondage, forced into converting to a Christian religion that brutalized them in the name of Christ. So this is why very sometimes you will hear in certain communities that Christianity is a white man's religion. Mm-hmm. Okay, everybody has heard that. And why there is such anger sometimes at Christians. KKK is a Christian organization. There are white supremacists that go to conferences that are Christian organizations. You understand what I'm saying? And people see this thing, and it's like, you want to really think I'm stupid? You see what's going on. So all of those things fuel the fires of Islam, pointing to that and pointing to your Bible, that if they were really Christian, they wouldn't do this. Not only that, but because the Torah says, if you do this, you are worthy of death. You have a group of people that believe God for his word and are willing to volunteer to be the executioners of God's word against infidels who choose to disobey the word. Okay? So we try to gloss all of this over by saying, well, maybe it really doesn't mean that in our minds. See, if we ever come to our right mind and really see what he's saying in here, we will get on our face and ask God for forgiveness. How do we make restitution? Let me ask you something. This whole lesson was about making restitution. Has America ever made restitution?
No.
Not at all. Not at all. The Torah was very clear. When you let that slave go, you don't let them go empty-handed. You don't let them go empty-handed. All right, that was never done. It was never done. Then we come up with these organizations that did what? Continue to persecute and all of that. So it's blood for blood for blood. At some point in time, there has to be a time when the scales of mercy and justice are balanced. The bad news is that we're probably in that time now. The good news is that we recognize some of the reasons why. And we can stand in the gap and ask God for mercy. Mercy does not stop the consequences. Mercy can lessen the consequences. In Ezekiel chapter 9, those who were sighing and crying about all of the abominations going on received the mark of God. Those who weren't received a sword. Okay? Which side do you want to be on? Okay? The sighing and the crying upon all of these things. Go to chapter 22, talks about, okay, making restitution. Chapter 22 is actually the chapter you want to read when you understand why God gave Job twice as much of everything. Okay? Because, once again, it was God himself, Yahweh himself, who allowed the thief to come in and steal from Job. All right? So, you know, in that case, he receives double for his trouble. Okay, listen. Okay. All right? So we see that in chapter 22, restitution. All right? Chapter 22, verse number 27 is very key. You shall not revile Elohim, nor put a curse upon a chieftain among your people. All right? So people have their panties in a wad right now because they say people are putting curses upon Donald Trump. But they forget 8 years before that, the very on the previous president. So you can't point to this and try to bring someone into guilt. That's a spirit of manipulation. A spirit of manipulation is a spirit of witchcraft. And the Bible says, thou shalt not permit a witch to live. You understand what I'm saying? So what goes around comes around. Okay. Seeds that were planted in the last 8 years, last Shemitah cycle, are going to come up in abundance during this time. Okay. And we are already seeing a lot of that. But the church, once again, doesn't have their head or their heart in the right place. Okay. Chapter 23. All right. You must not carry false rumors. You shall not join hands with the guilty to act as a malicious witness. Okay? We are seeing this go on in our government. Bigly. Okay, big time. Okay? We're seeing this. But God is saying, don't do that. You shall neither side with the mighty to do wrong. You shall not give perverse testimony in a dispute so as to pervert it in the favor of the mighty. Okay? You need to read this and then go listen to the news. All right? We have some serious problems that are going on right now. Okay, that the people of God need to be calling out, but they won't because they're so far gone. And God says, guess what God is doing? God is allowing us to see the truth. To see the truth. And people are choosing to lie. And he says, when you see the truth and you choose a lie, what will he do? Send you a delusion so that you will believe what? You'll believe the lies. You'll believe the lies. Okay. You'll believe the lies. Let me tell you something. I'm telling you, everybody online, everywhere, we are witnesses right now. This word is going to stand. I'm telling you, okay, people in Torah, Messianic movement, this word is going to be a witness for us. Or this word will be a witness against us. And trust me when I say, every time God gives us a word, he gives us an object lesson to see afterwards. And then based upon our response. Okay. So that is why all of this timing. Okay, right now. He goes on to say, you shall not side with the mighty to do wrong. You shall not give perverse testimony in a dispute so as to pervert it in the favor of the mighty. Nor should you show deference to a poor man in his dispute. So guess what? God is fair. You don't fare with the side with the mighty, but you also don't feel sorry for the poor and pervert justice either way. You understand what I'm saying? That's what makes God fair. All right, let's go down. Verse number 6. You shall not subvert the right of your needy in their disputes. Keep far from a false charge. Do not bring death on those who are innocent and in the right, for I will not acquit the wrongdoer. Do not take bribes, for bribes blind the clear-sighted and upset the pleas of those who are in the right. Now, you shall not oppress a stranger, for you know the feelings of a stranger, having yourself been strangers in the land of Egypt. They were refugees. If Egypt hadn't opened her borders to Israel, we would have a very short Bible. You understand what I'm saying? All right? Do you think it is any accident that right now a plan for that new ban is being planned for how to handle refugees? All the studies have been done. Okay? All the studies have been done by the new cabinet and all of that, the FBI and the CIA and all of those agencies, Department of Homeland Security. The report came back. Anybody listen to the news? The report came back. The report said there is no present danger in those particular countries for us over here. 3-page report. They want them to change the report.
Wow.
Find a reason why. They came and said, we can find no reason why. And these were appointees. Change the report. I'm listening to the news and I'm, what you say, God? What you say, God? You understand? He'll give you an object lesson. Be careful. Be careful. This is what I'm saying. God is allowing us to see certain things. He's giving us the commandment. Then he is saying, and judging based upon your reaction is going to determine. Let me tell you something. If you do not believe the truth when it is before your eyes, you will be marked as, boom, this one for this. Remember what we talked about, okay, on Thursday. When I say where to go, oh, these for the sword, these for the plagues, these for this, this one for the Antichrist, this one for, okay, Yeshua HaMashiach. That's what's going on right now, okay? Now, he goes on and talks about the 6 years sowing, okay, gathering in the yield, and then the Shemitah year. He talks about that. Verse number 12, 6 days you shall do your work, but on the seventh day you shall cease from labor in order that your ox and your ass may rest and that your bondsman and the stranger may be refreshed. So that is not a request. That is a commandment. Okay, then he goes on to say, be on guard concerning all that I have told you. Make no mention of the names of other gods. They shall not be heard on your lips. He goes into, once again, the feast days. He goes into the feast days, okay, about that. The rest of this chapter, he talks about in chapter 20. All right, I'm sending an angel before you to guard you. We already talked about that. Okay, it's very, very important angel. Chapter 24 is what? The ratification of the covenant. Because the ratification, he comes up with Nadab, Moses, come up to Yahweh. Come up to Yahweh. Okay, Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, 70 elders of Israel. 70 is the number of nations, right? Okay, so each one not only representing Israel, but representing the nations. Bow low from afar. Moses alone shall come near Yahweh, but the other shall not come near, nor shall the people come up with him. So what does Moses do? He repeats to the people. And what do the people say? All the things that Yahweh has commanded, we will do. In one voice. So what do? They come into agreement. All right, Moses writes down the commandments. Then he offers burnt offerings, sacrifice bulls, well-being, offerings of well-being. Verse number 6, he takes one part of the blood, puts it in the basin. The other part of the blood dashes against the altar. Then he takes the record of the covenant, read it aloud to the people. So this covenant is the covenant at Sinai. This is the covenant at Sinai. Deuteronomy is a different covenant. So this is the covenant entered into at Sinai. All right? So he reads it aloud to the people, and what do they do? Once again, say, all that Yahweh has spoken, we will faithfully do. Moses takes the blood and dashes it on the people and says, this is the blood of the covenant that Yahweh now makes with you concerning all these commands. Does that sound familiar, guys? Oh, yeah. Sounds exactly what Yeshua said at the Last Supper. The blood of the covenant. Take my flesh, the bread, my flesh and blood. This is the blood of the covenant that is shed for you. Now keep on. We have all of the elders there. Do you think it is any accident also that Yeshua in the Gospels called 70 others to go forth and have miracles along with the 12 that were his? Do you see the pattern and the picture? We have the 12, okay, tribes of Israel, 12 disciples. We have the 70 elders. We have the 70 doing miracles. And they all come back and do what? Verse 10, and they saw the God of Israel. Under his feet was the likeness of a pavement of sapphire, like the very sky for purity. Yet he did not raise his hand against the leaders of the Israelites. They beheld God, and they ate, and they drank. Revelation chapter 4, verse 3. Okay, here's a good one for that. You can do that later. Moses, Yahweh said to Moses, come up to me on the mountain and wait there. I will give you the stone tablets with the teachings and commandments which I have inscribed to instruct them. So Moses and Joshua arose. Moses goes up. He says to the elders, wait here for us to return to you. Think about it. We see Yahweh or Yeshua, what? Transform, the transformation. And you see Moses and Elijah. And Peter and them, okay, the three of them were there. Wow, let's make tabernacles for them. Same type of pattern that we see here, we see in the Gospels, okay? And then he goes on to say, verse 13, Moses and his attendant Joshua arose. Moses ascends the mountain, blah, blah, blah. Okay, verse 15, when Moses had ascended the mountain, the cloud covers the mountain, the presence of Yahweh abode on Mount Sinai, and the cloud hid it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called to Moses from the midst of the cloud. Now, the presence of Yahweh did what? Appeared to who? The sight of the Israelites as a consuming fire on the top of the mountain. How many of the Israelites you think saw that? All of them. And Moses went inside the cloud, ascended the mountain, and he remains on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Okay, we know what's about to happen after that. But it is during that time that he gives them, Terumah talks about worship. And that's why next week we are going to have Dan that is going to join us, because you need to know how to Terumah. Okay, and that's worship. You are worshiping with the gifts that God gives you. Very specifically. We're going to go over the Joseph factor. I'm going to pull out some nuggets for you from Job that I got. Okay? And also we're going to do this lesson, a short lesson. Next week is going to be a lot different. We have the youth facility, okay, next week also. So I'm going to tell you how I want everything set up and everything. But those who are on Facebook, please, please get friends and family. Okay, and if you have anybody, you know, that you want to bring, please bring them. Feel free to bring them. All right, so that we can get this thing straightened out. Okay, because we need, will not release finances you don't have. You can't handle. You understand? If you don't know what to properly do with what he's already placed in your hand, why should he give you more? Okay. So always remember, okay, one of the miracles is to take what you have in your hand and know how to multiply that. You understand what I'm saying? That's what we don't do very well. Yes. We do not do that very well. And that's a skill we need to learn, okay? So God will send messengers, okay, before you that have an expertise in that area to teach you if you want to learn. So that's what we're going to do, okay? Because I want everybody... This is a stressful situation that we're in as a nation. I don't want you guys stressed out in your finances or anything, but you need to prepare for what is coming down the pipe. And we are going to do that, all right? Everyone stand. We have quite a few out today. We said with Eduardo, I know Leroy had to work. He had to work. Just a lot of different things going on, okay, with people. So keep the family of God in prayer. Okay, please, you know, pray for Eduardo, pray for Bob, pray for my friend Ernest, who's been a big benefactor. In fact, those chairs you're sitting on were donated by Ernest many years ago, you know, and his father was having heart pains. They rushed him to the emergency room. So it's like within a 3-day period, you know, I had three people in ICU and everything. So it's been really rough. But God is a healer. Amen. And God is merciful.
Amen.
Okay. See, some people trust in things that man can do. We don't. We trust in the name of the Lord our God. We trust that God has given us a purpose. All right, and that purpose will be fulfilled, and no demon in hell. Let me tell you something. When you make up your mind, you're going to do what it is God says. Every demon in hell will be loosed against you, but no demon in hell can stop you. You understand what I'm saying? You make your face like flint towards that purpose and just keep on and just keep on with it. Father God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, we bless your holy name. Father, make our hearts constant towards you, O Heavenly Father. Open the eyes of our understanding so that we will be able to see and see. See your word, see your will. Yeah. And when we see in the physical, oh Lord, you teach us from the spiritual and what it is we are to do, oh Heavenly Father. Lord, you have anointed and appointed us for such a time as this. Father, I pray a blessing upon all those who are near and those who are afar. Father, bless them with the gift of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, and great favor in all that they do. So that when you release to their hands their wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, okay, will, O Heavenly Father, glorify you. Father, as they are obedient, O Heavenly Father, and people watch the great and mighty things that they do and say, what a God you have that has taught you such great and mighty laws, O Heavenly Father. Let their deeds glorify you, O Heavenly Father. Let us be a blessing to you, O Heavenly Father. That is ultimately our desire, that when people see us, they glorify you, O Heavenly Father. So, Lord, today we proclaim the name of Yahweh Yeshua HaMashiach as our Lord, our Master, and our Savior. And we thank you that we can call you our God as you call us your people, O Heavenly Father. So, Lord, we praise you and give you the glory, O Heavenly Father, for the greatness that you have placed within us. And, O Heavenly Father, we ask, O Lord, that our eyes be opened, our ears attend to your voice, and our hearts remain constant to you. Bless the fruit of our hands. Make our feet upon a clear path that we will clearly be able to discern your direction in our life. Father, we have children in schools, O Heavenly Father. Place your messengers around them to lead them and guide them, and bind the power of the enemy to hinder them. Open up their minds, O Heavenly Father, so that they will clearly get understanding from above and not below, a supernatural understanding of their lessons, so that they will be the head and not the tail in every single test, O Heavenly Father, that they are given. And Father, we just want to thank you. We speak shalom in the home. Shalom, shalom financially, shalom physically, shalom mentally, shalom emotionally, shalom in relationships, O Heavenly Father. Shalom on the job, shalom in the schools, shalom. Let our feet walk in shalom, O Heavenly Father. May shalom rule and reign from the crown of our heads to the soles of our feet, O Heavenly Father. And we do this and ask this, O Heavenly Father. In the mighty name of Yeshua HaMashiach, let everyone say, so be it. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. All right. All right.